Good evening, everyone, and I invite you to find a seat. There's always some in the front row, of course. It's wonderful to see such a good turnout tonight. It's delightful. And you're in for a treat, I think. So welcome to the annual Benjamin Eby Lecture at Conrad, Grebel University College. I'm Arming F., the interim dean here at the college. And I'm pleased to welcome you on behalf of President Susan Schultz-Huxton and my faculty colleagues here. The Eby Lecture has been presented almost annually by a faculty member of the college since 1981. The lecture presents an opportunity for the community, all of you here, to be informed and inspired by the scholarship of our faculty, all of whom, alongside their teaching and service work, are immersed in creative research activity that reflects their expertise. In fact, the scholarship that we do stimulates our teaching and service at the university and in the community. It is not incidental to the identity of a professor, but at the core of what draws us into academic life. Each year's topic is different and reflects the ideas and themes that emerge from our academic program areas. Last year, we heard from Professor Derek Suderman, who explored the Christian discomfort with the lament songs of the Old Testament. The year before that, Professor Susan Schultz-Huxman explored courageous rhetoricians who spoke truth to power in church and society. I'm pleased to announce that next year's Benjamin Eby Lecture will be presented by Dr. Jeremy Bergen. The topic is not quite confirmed, but I'm guessing it will have something to do with martyrdom. Another cheery topic. The Eby Lecture is regularly published in the Conrad Grebel Review, which is the college's scholarly journal. And there will be a display table with some recent issues for you to browse or to purchase single copies of in the atrium where we'll gather for a reception after the lecture tonight. The lecture series is named after Benjamin Eby, a teacher, preacher, bishop, farmer, and author who was among the first Mennonites from Pennsylvania to settle in what is today the Waterloo region. Eby arrived in 1807, and his legacy as an innovator in education and community building prompted the settlement, what is now Kitchener, to be called Ebytown in its early years. In an entry in the Dictionary of Canadian Biography, Eby is described thus, and I'm quoting, "His biggest contribution was in his own community, where he raised a large family, promoted a diversified economy, established a broadly based religious worship, introduced elementary school education, and inaugurated a literary tradition which served many generations. It is this tradition of education that we celebrate with this lectureship." Tonight we will hear from Dr. Troy Osborne on the bottle, the dagger, and the ring, church discipline, and Dutch Mennonite identity in the 17th century. I don't know about you, but titles that include church discipline make me a bit anxious. Anabaptist Mennonites don't like to talk about our tradition of church discipline so much. Well, Troy is a scholar of early modern Europe and Dutch Anabaptism, with an emphasis on the era of the Dutch Republic and the religious, social, and cultural life of Mennonites in that setting. He completed a PhD in 2007 at the University of Minnesota, and before that studied at Heston College, Goshen College, and AMBS, Anabaptist Mennonite Biblical Seminary. He came to Conrad Grebel from Lufkin University in 2011, and we trust that he has now completed his tour of Mennonite institutions of higher education. His recent publications include articles like the following: Mennonites and Violence in Early Modern Amsterdam, and the Development of a Transnational Mennonite Identity Among Swiss Brethren and Dutch Duitsgezinden in the 16th and 17th Centuries.
In 2013, Troy was commissioned by Herald Press to offer a new college-level textbook in Anabaptist and Mennonite history, which he hopes to complete in 2017. A huge task of selection and synthesis. Having read some of his chapters, I can say that Troy is a great storyteller, bringing the ideas and patterns of the Anabaptist past to life with anecdotes from the social history of real people. Troy teaches both undergraduate history and religious studies and theological studies courses at the University of Waterloo and graduate courses in our Master of Theological Studies program. His courses are on the 16th century Reformations, the Radical Reformation, Mennonite studies, and European history. Much of Troy's research takes him to Europe as often as he can. In fact, he became the first person to complete the former Inter-Menno trainee program twice, in Germany and Holland, mainly so that he could return to develop the language facility that prepared him for graduate studies. He also knows, in addition to German and Dutch, Latin and Spanish. But he has pretty much lost the Arabic he learned during the first 10 years of his life in Jerusalem, Egypt, and Jordan, where his parents were working with Mennonite Central Committee. Troy is married to Emma and father to Millie and Iris. Troy is an excellent scholar, popular teacher, and wonderful colleague with a great sense of humor and a wealth of historic and present-day trivia always ready to be shared. Well, I'm sure his lecture tonight will be much more than trivia. Please welcome Dr. Osborne to tell us about the bottle, the dagger, and the ring.
Thank you, Marlene, for that generous introduction. Thank you, Presidential Tuxman, and my colleagues, and Conrad Grebel, for inviting me to present this year's Benjamin Eby Lecture. I often think I have a lot in common with Benjamin Eby. Both of us were born in America, moved to Ontario, have hay fever, and are shorter than everybody else around us. So tonight, I will use church discipline to discuss changes in Mennonite identity in the 17th century. So I'll begin with the story. On August 1, 1680, Marians van der Heuvel and Peter Mellis appeared before the Board of Elders of the Amsterdam Lambeth Congregation for reports about their discordant and bad domestic life, especially the rumors that Peter stayed out late at night. The couple did not deny the rumors, but they promised that they would improve after the elders threatened to tell the rest of the brethren of their actions and behavior. Less than 2 months later, Peter reappeared again and was this time earnestly admonished about his drunkenness and his conflict with his wife, whom he had threatened with a knife and chased out of the house. The elders at that time decided to cut off his charitable support and kicked him out of his church housing. And despite warnings that he would be entirely ousted from the congregation, Peter's behavior continued down a dangerous path. In 1684, the board summoned Peter again for smashing a hole in Michael Simon's head with his mug. In 1687, the elders tell the congregation that despite previous warnings and promises of improvement, Peter continues to go to taverns and waste his time. The next year, the board learned that Peter had again threatened to cut his wife's throat. So, when Peter petitioned to rejoin the congregation in 1695, a skeptical board of elders decided that the testimonies of his improved behavior were not strong enough to admit him back into the congregation. So the story today will highlight several of the themes that you'll hear today. What can discipline cases like Peter's tell historians? It's part of a larger question of social discipline in the 17th and 16th century. This is known as Europe's confessional age, a time when Catholic and Protestant churches created institutions, worked with states, and formed programs to clarify the boundaries between groups and internally strengthen confessional identity of their members. Some scholars have called the Anabaptists non-confessional, but as they grew more enmeshed into the surrounding society Mennonites in the Dutch Republic and Northern Germany, like their Protestant and Catholic neighbors, used tools like confessions, martyrologies, hymns, catechisms, and church discipline to instill a greater devotion in their members and differentiate themselves from other denominations as well as other groups of Mennonites. So changing practices in church discipline, I'm going to argue today, show us changing understandings of Mennonite identity. It also gives us access to changes in the so-called golden age of the Dutch Republic. Those of you who may be familiar with Dutch Mennonite history are probably more familiar with couples like these two here, the ones that are painted by famous artists or commissioned artistic works themselves. We know a lot less about the common men and women of that period. This is what the historian Adi van Diersen has called the small change in the golden era, or the copper coins in the golden era. So part of the reason I like studying church discipline is that it's at least sometimes we hear the voice of those who didn't always record what they thought and what they did. So just a little background to begin with about Mennonite history in the Dutch Republic. Anabaptists had been gathering in Amsterdam since the 1530s. By the 17th century, there was a wide range of Mennonite and Anabaptist groups. So I'll just point out here on the map several of the congregations. The conservative Old Flemish group met at the Nieuwe Zijds Voorburgswals at a small church called the Six Kraukjes, or the Six Mugs. There were also two different types of Frisian Mennonites. The Noah's Ark congregation, and the conservative Jan Jacobs congregation. There was also a High German congregation, but we don't know actually where they met at the time. My study of Anabaptists focuses on the six largest Mennonite groups. The other groups' records, by the way, part of the reason I don't know what they did, and I'm not talking about them today, is that they just simply didn't keep records that we have still today. So my study draws from 150 years records of the three largest Amsterdam congregation. The oldest congregation and most numerous congregation initially was the more moderate Waterlander congregation, named because it was found here by one of the towers. It's called By the Tower, and it was located by one of the gates into the city. That's its interior there. And it had about 1,000 members in about 1615. In 1668, the Waterlanders merged with the slightly more conservative Flemish congregation, known as the Church by the Lamb. This would be the church that if you go to Amsterdam today, this would be the one that you would visit. So that's the interior that, if you've been to that church, still looks roughly the same to the present day. And in 1664, there was a dispute among the Lamist congregation, the combined Lamist and Waterlander congregation, about the role of printed confessions. And a group of about 500 members split off and left to worship at the warehouse known as The Sun. That's down here at the bottom. So today I'll really be talking about, the Waterlander congregation, then the Lamist congregation, and the Somist congregation. It's those three largest, oldest sort of congregations. Amsterdam had a rainbow of Mennonite-related groups because many of the splits that had divided the movement at the end of the 16th century. It's sort of ironic that at the same time that the Mennonites grew more intolerant of each other, they had gained a degree of religious freedom and toleration in the young Dutch Republic. The founding document of the Dutch Republic, the so-called Union of Utrecht, guaranteed that all subjects would have freedom of conscience, stating that nobody shall be persecuted or examined for religious reasons. The Calvinist Reformed Church became the publicly recognized church of the young nation, but the authorities agreed to tolerate, or at least connive, the existence of other confessions for the sake of public harmony and concord. So after decades of persecution, Mennonites willingly accepted their secondary status in the Republic and the accommodations that they were granted. The authorities did not force Mennonites to marry in Reformed churches, but allowed them to marry in front of magistrates. And instead of serving in the military, Mennonites could perform watch duty or help build city defenses. Rather than swearing oaths, Mennonites could use simple affirmations that sufficed as legally acceptable alternatives to swearing an oath. And while they were forbidden from building churches that might entice the curiosity of passers-by, they could build concealed churches or hidden churches behind facades of warehouses or homes. So everybody knows they're there, but at least we can pretend the fiction that there are no Mennonites living there. So this here is the, behind these three buildings here, is that Lamaist congregation that you see today. So who were these people that we're studying today? In her study of the socioeconomic background of the Waterlander congregation, historian Mary Sparger concluded that 10%, or about 50 households of the congregation, would have been considered wealthy by contemporary standards. And at the other end of the socioeconomic scale, 15 to 18% of the members, the majority of whom lived in the newer parts of the city, relied on church charity for their survival. So you have the top end of the congregation, with the elites who actively participated in the commerce and trade of the Republic. Waterlanders were active in the foreign trade. They invested in the nation's mother trade in the Baltic, as well as fishing, shipping, and industry. Mennonites were also active in the cultural world of the Dutch Republic. Joost van den Vondel, sort of the Shakespeare of the Dutch Republic, grew up and was a deacon in the Waterlander congregation. Other Mennonites became doctors, professors, artists, and our patrons. And it's this staggering wealth that the richest families concentrated amongst themselves through intermarriage that supplied the funds for the church's active poor relief, which fed, housed, and clothed the congregation's neediest members. However, despite remarkable wealth and remarkable poverty, Mary Sprugger's difficult and careful work in the archives reminds us that the large majority of Amsterdam Waterlander Mennonites were from the bottom half of occupational levels. So we can't be too distracted by the significant wealth that there actually was there. In the Dutch Republic, which allowed lots of different faiths to exist, individuals could choose which confession to join and whether or not to join any church at all. Like Catholics, Lutherans, and Reformed groups, Mennonites worked hard using sermons, confessions, songs to develop members' denominational identity and loyalty. At the end of the 16th century, most Mennonites held that they needed to be cleansed from any spot or wrinkle by using discipline to control wayward members. The early Anabaptists desired a visible, pure church of regenerated believers, which led to an emphasis on church discipline as the primary mechanism of maintaining the integrity of the congregation. For Menno Simon's followers, the question was never whether to discipline members, but there was always the question was who should do the disciplining and how strict did it need to be. Even the more moderate Waterlanders called for milder practices of discipline, still disciplined their members. So what was the theory behind discipline? In an undated and unpublished treatise on church discipline, this man here, Reinier Weybrands, who was an elder in the Amsterdam Waterlander congregation, wrote a disciplined practice so that, quote, the congregation would remain at peace and everyone's conscience could remain free and unconstrained. At the heart of discipline, Weybrands understood that there were two types of the ban, the greater and lesser ban. The greater ban, or excommunication, was when the congregation weren't pronouncing their judgment, but God's judgment on the offender, whose actions had already separated themselves from God and the congregation. Excommunications only occurred with serious offenses, he wrote. More conservative Old Flemish or Hard Frisian congregations practiced shunning, which was the social avoidance of excommunicated members. Other than greetings required by common courtesy, all social interaction with the offender was forbidden. Now, shunning does not happen among the three churches that we're going to talk about today. I've looked hard to find it, and I can never find any case of it at all. Perhaps we'll talk more about this at the end of the presentation today. Congregations more frequently pronounced the lesser ban, which temporarily denied members access to the communion table without losing their membership in the congregation. The lesser ban's primary goal, Rainier wrote, was to bring forth the shame and the repentance of the offender, although the punishment might also serve as an example to warn others against sinning. Discipline, he concluded, should be administered with care in order that the sinner might repent and reconcile with the congregation. Before communion, ministers, two elders visited with members in their homes, and the congregation heard a special preparatory sermon. If a member's offense was not publicly known, an elder would admonish him or her privately about the need to improve their behavior. But if the sin was publicly known, the offender had to appear in front of the church board. A recalcitrant member who continued to walk in sin would be admonished by the council to abstain from taking communion. If she continued to lead a wayward life, regardless of continued admonition, the church council would require an appearance in front of the congregation, at which point the offending member could be cut off completely from the congregation if everybody agreed. So it sounds sort of serious and rigorous. Now, as it's important to remember, as a correction to earlier historians of social control and discipline, who emphasized the top-down structure of church discipline, historians now emphasize the importance of the horizontal forces of honor and shame in the discipline of the church. In addition to the state, there are other forces for conformity, like the family, neighbors, and the communion presence. You could even go to a small claims court to defend your honor. Right? It was almost had a real physical value to it. Dutch men protected their honor regarding their financial affairs, and women guarded their sexual reputation. Sometimes, members would rather risk aggravating their offense and punishment and refuse to appear in front of the congregation because the public shame was too overwhelming. So in a pluralistic context, honor and shame were critical to the functioning of discipline. Without them, the spiritual care of the church would have had no teeth. The board believed that it was especially important to reprimand dishonorable behavior in public, done in public, lest it tarnish the public reputation and honor of the entire congregation. Just as individuals could lose their honor in the eyes of their neighbors, the elders were convinced that they had to monitor the behavior of their members, lest sin ruin the honor of the entire congregation in the eyes of the rest of the city. For example, the church had been when Gerrit Femkes and his wife Lisbeth Schultes grew so scandalously unpeaceful that the neighbors complained. Right, that was the sort of the moment that they felt they had to step in. Lisbeth admitted that she struggled to control her temper when she was insulted and admitted that this threatened the congregation's collective honor. And they asked her to refrain from communion because of the public shame on the entire congregation. So in the Dutch Golden Age, your moral reputation was almost the same as your credit in a financial sense. That is, everybody kept credit in a moral sense. The board maintained the reputational solvency of the congregation by disciplining its members. Now, after a sufficient length of time, separated members could appeal to the board. Now, ideally, you would do it with tears as the sign of your sincerity. If your remorse appeared genuine, you could once again approach the communion table. 4 years after her exclusion for her extramarital pregnancy, Annika Wouters was admitted to the table since nothing negative regarding her life had arisen during that period, and she had demonstrated her repentance with many tears, according to the records. Like all censured members, the final step to Annika's admittance was her own self-examination. If her conscience was clear, she could rejoin the congregation. Given the multi-confessional nature of the Dutch Republic, you might ask whether the threat of discipline would have mattered at all, because you could simply have joined another church or decided not to go to church at all. The records indicate, though, that members usually wanted to be seen to take communion. You usually wanted to have access to it, both for its importance as a religious symbol and to have your honor reinstated. As Charles Parker described, a person's right to take communion establishes their innocence and hence their moral honor. And since so much of the business in Amsterdam happened on a personal, face-to-face basis, public loss of honor had drastic, or could have drastic economic consequences. So because your honor was your credit, and Amsterdamers needed credit to survive. And for the poor of the congregation, it's particularly important to be in good favor with the church. Being censured could result in the loss of support or your room in one of the church's what they're called hofjes, small courtyards where people would live together. Care of the poor in Amsterdam was divided among confessional lines. Each church was responsible for taking care of their own members. So in addition to suffering the shame and loss of honor, poor members faced having to find a new source of financial support or a new residence. For example, Hendrik Burgers and Marieke Spelsteker committed adultery. They had to leave the church housing and lost their congregational charity until the deeds of their lives matched their promises of repentance. But I do want to point out that despite the extra high stakes for the poor, the record shows that all that discipline was applied to all levels of the Guadalajara congregations. It was not only a top-down sort of phenomenon. All right, let's look at the three categories then today. According to Dutch moralists, alcohol and drinking was the mother sin, the moederzonde, because alcohol abuse led to many of the more grievous sins, such as violence, stealing, or bankruptcy. At the same time, alcohol was an essential element of Dutch culture. Drinking was a sign of friendship, a toast celebrated the birth of a child, and merchants often sealed the deal with a drink. To demonstrate their masculinity, men were expected to consume large amounts of alcohol, but without overindulging and losing control. Men had essentially a duty to drink as much as they could without losing it. Women protected their honor by maintaining their sobriety in order to protect their chastity. But despite constant moralizing against the dangers of immoderate drinking, the 17th century cliché of the drunken Dutchman likely contained more than a kernel of truth. In a city known for the stench of its canals, people only drank water when beer and wine ran out. By 1613, a thirsty Amsterdamer could slake his thirst in a choice of 513 taprooms, that's one for every 200 residents, ranging from inns and taverns to side rooms and cellars and apothecaries. Beer was the standard drink of the lower classes, and it ranged in quality from watered-down beer with low alcohol to thick, high-quality brews. Statistics suggest that the average person drank between 300 and 670 liters of beer annually in 1625. Even though there were no vineyards in the Dutch Republic, or no sun, Dutch merchants imported large amounts of wine, the preferred drink of the upper classes. The lower classes preferred beer, but as brandy, wine, and gin grew more affordable over the course of the 17th century, the more potent drinks grew more popular, and we think that the average drinker of hard liquor consumed between 17 to 23 liters of brandy or gin a year. So, to avoid excessive drink and the sin of gluttony, one axiom advised drinking three glasses a day, the first for your health, the second for its taste, and the third for a good night's rest. In a society in which everyone drank, Reformed and Mennonite discipline records made a distinction between private drinking and public and continual drunkenness. Mennonites who engaged in obnoxious drunken behavior, such as vomiting, breaking glasses, or urinating in their beer mugs, clearly stood outside of broader social norm. Right? These aren't just Mennonite problems. And drunkenness resulting from stronger alcohol, such as brandy or anise water, resulted in elders banning Hartwig Janssen's wife in 1618, 1619, and again in 1620. The board disciplined other members for going to inns, even though one prominent waterlander owned an inn that was an Amsterdam tourist attraction famous for its waterworks. Unfortunately, no longer exists. Most members, however, were confronted simply for rumors that they had drank to the point of drunkenness. And in Dutch, it's called dronken drinken. So despite the way it fulfilled social roles and quenched thirst, it's clear that there were socially unacceptable ways to drink. And the largest number of cases that come in front of the elders dealt with drunkenness and alcohol played a contributing role to most of the other cases. Normally, the ministers had only passed the lesser ban on members who occasionally became drunk. But if a member was repeatedly found drunk, especially to the point that he or she became violent or could no longer keep an orderly house, the board excommunicated them because the New Testament claimed that only a drunkard could not inherit the kingdom. So over a third of the excommunications were for continual drunkenness, making it the most common offense to receive the greater ban. The waterlander struggle against drinking intensified in the 1640s and the 1650s, but they do not appear to have been winning the war by the time of their merger with the Flemish congregation. So they start new records then after the merger. And in the records of this new congregation from the second half of the 17th century, the most common offenses again, which the board dealt with, involve alcohol. 182 of our 793 total cases mention abusive drinking. And even in the more conservative Zionist church, 19 of the 117 cases involved drinking as well. In the worst incidents, the drinking was so severe that one member sold the feathers from their bed and the clothing from their children to pay for her alcohol. Another was so drunk that she had to be carried home by someone else. Now, as would have been the case for all Dutchmen, the problem with excessive drinking was that it was continual, public, and usually led to other types of offensive. Perhaps because it was an everyday occurrence, it's understandable that church members called before the board to defend their drinking, and they would defend their drinking, because the line between acceptable and excessive drinking is unclear. Little Hansje, or Kleine Hansje, for example, argued that he could not have been drunk because he always drank on a full stomach. Therefore, it's impossible. Similarly, the types of drink that were permitted also changed. Anthony Prode protested that drinking brandy could no longer be considered uncommon or offensive, since the Waterlanders and even the more conservative Flemish Mennonites consumed it. At the end of the second half of the century, there are also more accounts of women being drunk. This is similar to what Hermann Rodenberg found in the records of the Reformed churches. So it could be that drinking was less of a masculine act at that time. However, Rodenberg suggested simply that the records can't be bothered anymore to record all the cases of drunk men, and so the record keepers were more interested in the scandalous cases of drunk women. So it's hard to know what to do with those gender shifts. After about 1730, the records grow silent about drinking. Hermann Rodenberg has found that same pattern in Reformed consistory records. And it's difficult to know whether it's the moralizing of the discipline that succeeded in making a sober congregation, or members of drinking endangered their charity, simply stop attending that church. So another story here. On September 13, 1618, the Waterlander board summoned Ryer Janssen and his wife Anitja on account of a recent fight that the couple had had with Martin Joost and his wife. According to the elders' records, a quarrel between the two women had escalated to the point that they pulled each other's caps off and hit one another. As the fight continued, Martin tried to pull the two women apart, but Ryer encouraged his wife, saying, "Sit, hit, Janken, or Anitja, hit." And when questioned by the elders, Ryer admitted that he once struck a baker with tongs until he bled, and that he and his brother also hit each other. Ryer confessed that he and his wife fought, and he once bruised his wife's arm so badly that she became bedridden. The elders' examination and admonition appeared not to have worked their desired effect on Ryer. Later, he and his brother armed themselves with a hammer and went to fellow Mennonite Martin Joost's house, where they pounded on the window and doors, trying to break into the home. And when the brothers came upon Martin's servant, they sliced open his jerkin and his trousers. Subsequently, the congregation found Ryer and his wife's misdeeds so great and the contrition so unsatisfactory, they excommunicated the couple and encouraged them to repent and do penance. Now, Ryer's violent and disruptive lifestyle shocked and offended his fellow Mennonites. Despite a general acceptance of low-level interpersonal violence in Amsterdam, it was sort of violence was a part of everyday life for everybody. Both the Reformed and the Mennonite churches would have condemned Ryer's actions as unchristians. Mennonites shared a cross-confessional consensus that condemned private violence, while simultaneously respecting, even endorsing, the state's monopoly of violence. In other words, Mennonites' attitudes towards violence did not differ from those of other Dutch Christians, even though the principle of defenselessness was at the key emphasis of Anabaptist Mennonite identity. So I'll divide my discussion of violence with you today into two categories. The first is interpersonal violence, the first is collective violence, the second is interpersonal violence. And it's in this first category that Mennonites most clearly differentiated themselves from their neighbors. How they handled members who joined the military, the militia, or sailed on armed ships. Dutch authorities had granted Mennonites exemptions from serving in the city guard, so there's no legal requirement for them to seek those roles. And it was usually poorer men who were financially desperate who signed up to work in the Navy, or work join the Army, or serve with the East India Company. And the elders understood this economic need, and they that compelled young men to join up. So when Ida Klaus and Achilles Cornelsen admitted to sailing to war against the English in 1665, they explained that they only did so because of their great poverty. The ministers informed them that if that was actually the case, they could require a secret loan rather than sail to war. But it's clear that it's more than just poverty that drove some men to exist, because these men are already often at the margins of congregational life. Many of the men who sailed to war were also often admonished for drinking, for abandoning their families while they were away, not always simply for sailing, for joining the military. And once they returned from war, they usually only received the lesser ban, or separation from the Lord's table from their offense. They didn't lose their membership for doing so. Even though the rejection of the sword was one of the Mennonites' core tenets, the elders usually preferred to keep the member from the communion table instead of cutting him off entirely. So of the 39 men who sailed in armed ships, there are only 6 cases where the offender is excommunicated specifically for that offense. Peter the Yacher, in 1615, refused to repent for doing so. While in a Turkish prison, Peter had fought and killed 3 other prisoners in self-defense. And sometime either before or after the time in prison, he'd sailed on a ship that had thrown 88 Turkish prisoners overboard. Peter explained that he was at the rudder at the time and could have done nothing to stop the slaughter. Nonetheless, the scale of the killings and Peter's refusal to repent had clearly moved him beyond the boundaries of Waterlander Mennonite principles. But apart from clear cases like Peter's, where military participation was the primary offense, the elders usually just kept people with the lesser ban, kept them from the communion table. So violating this key Mennonite principle did not sever you completely from the community. Whereas there was some forbearance with poorer men who joined the military, the ministers were less sympathetic with respectable, wealthy members who armed their ships. The short entries for sailors in the records contrast noticeably with shipowners and captains' entries in the records, which are much more expansive about the violation and the efforts to dissuade the men from arming them. When Anska Focus was pressed into service as a captain in 1665, the preacher and elder Dennis van der Schroeder recorded his attempts to convince him that sailing to war was against their religion. Van der Schroeder wrote that because they considered themselves defenseless Christians who understood the gospel to say that only God can seek revenge, Mennonites were to turn the other cheek to their enemies. If Anska's understood the faith, he continued, he should have understood that he could not become a man of war, much less a captain on a warship. Doing so engendered scandalous talk about the congregation and disturbed the simpler members. When Alska, who seemed surprised to learn of this Waterlander position, asked how he could hold his head up before other people, assumingly people outside the Waterlander congregation, the elder retorted that he should be more concerned how he should hold his head up before God. And because Anska's planned to continue with his voyage into war, the ministers banned him from the Lord's table until he returned and the congregation could observe his life much more closely. By the end of the 17th century, the elders no longer banned or admonished members who joined the military or navy. In early 1696, the Lammas Church asked Haya Heemstra to refrain from the Lord's table because he not only armed his ships, but was sailing under commission from the Navy, which they said was to cause great offense. When Haya asked for permission to take communion, the board said, well, it could not tolerate his behavior. They did say, though, that it was a provisional separation, and that they would not tell the rest of the brethren unless he continued. So there appears to have been some leniency to members who sailed in armed ships if they did not sail under commission. But the decision to refrain from public censure suggests a change in attitude. They began to leave decisions about military participation up to the individual conscience of members. In 1699, Frederick Jacobs, a sailor on an admiralty ship, asked to take communion with the congregation. The board told him that he'd be able to do so upon his self-examination, in other words, if his conscience allowed him to do so. And after 1695, the records of all 3 congregations contain no further accounts of discipline for joining the military. The last discipline of a member for sailing with the East India Company occurred in 1712. So, in addition to enforcing the prohibition on armed service, the church boards worked to reduce interpersonal violence among their members. There are 39 cases of what I'm calling interpersonal violence, ranging from street fights to domestic violence. Most of these cases involve members living in church housing or from the lowest classes. The congregation had more success in disciplining members who relied on church charity, and at the other end of the social scale, they were more effective with those people who worried about honor. Peter Everett Schwartz's case in 1678 serves as a typical example of this. The board tried to summon Peter for assaulting another church member in the street. He simply refused to appear and replied he was planning to leave the congregation anyway. But many of these violent acts occurred between two spouses. Usually, but not always, men assaulted their wives. Whereas attitudes towards war and military were gendered exclusively to men, domestic violence or neighbor-to-neighbor violence involved nearly as many women as men. But what is interesting is that, like Reformed church practice, the Mennonites generally concentrated their efforts at reconciling quarreling couples, because you needed to be reconciled with your fellow church members in order to take communion. The elders would ban you for quarreling, but not necessarily for the physical violence. Many of the marital records often involved heavy drinking by one or both partners. Members were summoned to the board because they were drunk or they were rumored to keep bad house. Now, this is a phrase that appears a lot, and I used to be confused by it. Still am a little confused by it. It's called schlechte Haushaltung. They don't really go into detail what it is until just about 2 weeks ago. I found a picture of good housekeeping. There's a very orderly family. We could question how wise this decision down here is. Put the baby by the fire. But then the pamphlet on the other side talks about schlechte Haushaltung. And so it's clear that it includes a lot of stuff. So it's a wide variety of offenses. Most of the cases for bad housekeeping came to the elders' attention, concerned members living in the church housing, because deacons kept a closer eye on these residents' behavior. Plus, the close quarters of the church, the four houses, made it hard to keep marital fighting quiet from neighbors' always alert ears. A violation of marital tranquility and the narrowing the narrow and bustling alleys and homes of Dutch families brought shame on the entire neighborhood, which might have compelled Mennonite neighbors to bring the case to the attention of the elders. Again, ministers typically tried to reconcile sparring spouses. They never advised divorce or even temporary separation in order to diminish the level of violence between the couple. In the Reformed congregation, there were occasions for adult divorce in cases of adultery and malicious abandonment. But they would allow for cases of divorce for irreconcilable couples. Mennonites, on the other hand, always banned couples and never allowed for divorce. Some of the offenders would repent of their marital discord and only receive the lesser ban for their violence. Laurens Peter's case holder, on the other hand, was told that he could not be considered a brother of the congregation as long as he hit and shoved his wife so hard that he bruised her. There does seem to have been some sort of an assessment by the board about the degree of violence, public knowledge, and visible bruising crossed a tolerance. It's unclear, though, whether the board condemned Lawrence because he violated prohibition against revenge and violence, or because he had violated the broader social disapproval of tyrannical husbands. Right? There was a general understanding that husbands should not behave as tyrants to their wives. And in some cases, the lack of domestic tranquility and a push for reconciliation seems to have been more important than the fact that the husband hit his wife, or that the wife hit their husband. In 1646, Lord Peter's wife left him because they could not live peacefully together, and he hit her black and blue. But because Lubert was repentant and asked for forgiveness, the elders decided simply to watch his life a little bit more closely. His wife left him 5 years later, refused to reconcile with him, and the elders asked both of them to refrain from the communion table. The problem was that they were unreconciled, not that Lubert beat her. Outside of the domestic sphere, the episodes of Mennonite physically assaulting someone reflected the same type of incidents found in Reformed records. 23 cases concerned men in places like taverns, streets, or their work. There are also 12 reports of Mennonite women who were violent towards their neighbors or co-workers. And at least 5 of the incidents of assault, members threatened somebody with a knife. This was considered to be a much more serious offense than simple fist fights. Knife fighting or carrying a dagger for protection was usually associated with these semi-respectable lower classes. Since respectable lower middle class people fought with staffs or their fists. This class division of fighting is reinforced by the fact that Mennonite knife fighters come before the court for multiple offenses, such as fraud, bankruptcy, frequenting dishonorable houses, or drunkenness. And when members fought each other, or with someone else outside the congregation, they had to refrain from the communion table until they resolved their differences. And in most of these cases, the aim was not to punish for the violence, but to enforce the unity of the Lord's table. So, and to encourage members to reconcile with each other. In 1660, Acha Elkers pulled his knife on someone in the Newburg neighborhood and was wounded. The Waterlander board said he needed to stay away from the table, which he agreed to do. 2 years later, after he was reconciled, people had heard that he behaved himself. Acha repented of his sins and promised to improve his life. The elders readmitted him to the communion table if his conscience allowed it. So, arming your ships was grounds for excommunication, but violent personal lives did not automatically end your membership in the church. Although elders attempted to adhere to the tradition of Mennonite defenselessness, it's unclear what Mennonite identity meant to their violent marginal members, many of whom lived in church housing. If Mennonites believed that congregations should be a community of believers who committed themselves to a life of discipleship, what does it mean to this underclass of Mennonites? Perhaps they're simply legacy members whose parents had once been devout Mennonites but chose to remain and identify as Mennonites for the charity, even though they could have left the church. Was financial support so important that they were glad to agree to a minimal understanding of Mennonite identity? By the 18th century, this minimal understanding seems to have taken hold because the amount of discipline declined significantly. Just like Mennonite discipline of violence illustrates how Mennonites share the values of other Amsterdammers, the discipline around sexuality and marriage likewise reflects changing understandings of how Mennonites understand their place in Dutch society. In the interest of time, I'm just going to skip a little bit here to talk about a particular Mennonite identity around the practice of mixed marriage. And it's in the practice, even though all groups in Amsterdam enforced endogamy, right, marriage within your own church, the changing practice of mixed marriage shines a light on Mennonite understanding of the relationship to the broader world. Marriage provokes an easy route for sin to corrupt a church without spot or wrinkle by conjoining both the fleshly world with the spiritual one. The records show that even the moderate Waterlanders considered mixed marriage a serious offense. It occurred 64 times, and it's second only to drunkenness in the total number of cases handled by the board. Mennonites condemned mixed marriages since the 1530s and had led to many of the splits of the 16th century. Most conservative groups disciplined every case and banned even Mennonites who married other Mennonites from different traditions. Waterlanders only punished those Mennonites who married outside of the church. Most of the Mennonite discipline controlled the members' behavior, but it's this particular discipline of mixed marriage where it's really about maintaining a Mennonite identity. In the earliest years, the bans for mixed marriage could last up to 3 years, but over time, the discipline appears to have developed into sort of a formality, especially in cases where a member promised to remain in the church and be a light and example for their spouse. Henrik Foster's even took it upon himself to refrain from communion, although he had married an honorable woman who didn't attend any church, and they hoped to eventually win her over. More troubling cases of mixed marriage occurred when members married somebody with a poor public reputation or somebody who married against the will of the ministers. A woman named Alba Chin married a scoundrel against the advice of her mother and then left the man after he came after the mother with a knife. The waterliners kicked Abilene out, but she had clearly moved herself outside the boundaries of the congregation. They recorded that she hadn't been to a sermon for 2 or 3 years and refused to appear when some. So over the course of the century, there was a growing sense among those who married non-Mennonites that they would have to answer to the church for their choice of spouse. As long as they continued to attend the congregation, the punishment was a temporary one and not a significant loss of honor. The church seems to have tolerated mixed marriages of wealthier members more easily. There are times where sort of giving 50 guilders a year to the church poor box seems to have lessened the punishment that you received. Perhaps there is some justification in the fear that marriages to non-Mennonites might have made it easier to move away from one's commitment to Mennonite distinctives. In 1657, delegates from the church board confronted Jacob Fankel about his clothing. He blamed the finery of his dress on his marriage to a reformed woman. He argued that his wife forced him to conform to a dress code that was less restrictive than those the waterlanders had. Over time, the Lammas congregation no longer viewed mixed marriage as a threat to the congregation, to the purity of the congregation, and the unity of communion, but they continued to discourage the practice for different reasons. The city magistrates of Amsterdam required churches to financially support needy members, and thereafter the board worried that marriage was a channel for outsiders to gain access to the poor chest of this wealthy congregation. In 1690, after much heartfelt sorrow, as their words, the board presented a new regulation about mixed marriage to the congregation. They created a policy to deal with members whose spouses were not members of any Mennonite congregation, who drank, did not work or attend church, and yet lived off the charity of the congregation. From that point on, anyone who married somebody from outside the congregation, who was a dangerous model for the children, would receive only one half of their charitable support. So any marriages to shackle to such inappropriate and unchristian people would receive no money, food, or shelter from the congregation. Right? So what they're essentially doing is making it impossible for marginal people to join the congregation. In 1690, the ministers added a provision that if the mixed marriage was between virtuous people, they became unable to support themselves, a three-quarters vote by the entire board would allow the member to receive charity. So they sort of realized the harshness of the original position and backed off of it a bit. And the records of mixed marriage drop off significantly, essentially stop after 1700. Perhaps in order to protect its considerable financial resources and the respectability of the congregation, it was too financially risky for members to take up with marginal members of other congregations. But Ben Kaplan has found that one-third of the Mennonite marriages in 1760 were to somebody from another confession. By that time, confessional differences were no longer barriers to mixed marriage, a trend that German traveler Simon LaRousse noted in 1743, and even as early as the 19th century, the historian Laupert and Conta suggested that it's mixed marriages that were to blame for the steep drop in Mennonite numbers. Mennonites tended to join the congregation of the person that they married. So, just a little bit by way of conclusion. Now, what do we do with all these cases and all this change? Why did a group for whom discipline and purity the gathered community stop disciplining its members? The changing discipline around alcohol, violence, and marriage shows the degree to which Amsterdam Mennonites are already integrated into Dutch society. This is what I realize. The remaining vestiges of any separate identity had disappeared totally by the 18th century. So from the 20th century, I think when we think of church discipline, you know, we have these, as Marlene says, we have these images of, it brings bad feeling to us about sort of harsh bishops enforcing Mennonite or Amish peculiarities, like my grandma's sisters who were all excommunicated for wearing rings. But with the exception of sailing to war, Mennonites are concerned about the exact same sins as the other faiths in Amsterdam. They are disciplining not because they are separate from the world, but because they are fully part of it. Although the data shows a clear change in discipline, or at least in the recording of discipline, this leaves some difficult questions about what the changes mean. Had the congregation actually succeeded in creating a well-disciplined church? Were Mennonites less willing to discipline and be disciplined? There seems to be some indication that members were simply tired of it. They were standing up for themselves and not willing to be disciplined. Jan Peter Swerth in 1677 wrote a letter to the board reminding them that everybody was a sinner and that only those without sin could cast the first stone. Johannes Blau, a long-term alcoholic, refused to appear unless he learned the name of his accusers. Waldorf and Slitter appeared in 1699 with two witnesses to ask to be reaccepted into the congregation. The board decided that he needed more evidence of true repentance, so he could not join. At that point, an outraged Waldorf threatened to reveal the name of a minister in that room, who should also refrain for communion. So it seems that there's more, greater resistance among this sort of wealthier, more sort of perhaps self-confident group of people. For the church, membership in the congregation is based upon your adherence to three points of identity. What it meant to be a Mennonite in the Lammas congregation was defenselessness, the non-swearing of the oath, and adult baptism. Virtuous behavior and affirmation of those three principles is more important than claim to be the exclusive body of Christ or agreeing to a printed confession of faith. Lammists could agree to take communion with anybody who agreed to those principles and demonstrated a greater, and they demonstrated a greater openness to the world around them. But there's a bit of an irony. At the same time that the Lammists were much more welcoming around the communion table, they were growing more careful about whom they allowed to become a member. In the second half of the 17th century, and during periods of economic downturn, the wealth of Amsterdam's shipyards, its warehouses, and its markets attracted men and women from all over the Dutch Republic. Thereafter, the Lammists scrutinized potential members more carefully, making it much more difficult for poor or ill-behaved members to join and burdening the congregation. Therefore, in addition to fulfilling a Christian and required civic duty, the Lammist charity also functioned as a type of discipline to shape the social makeup of their membership. However, the change is that in addition, the discipline ends up focusing more on the powerless members of the congregation and granting the better sort more leeway. Prospective members have to present an attestation of their good standing. So this is one attestation in the archives. The congregation also required that you had to live in the city for at least a year before you could join. This allowed current members to watch your behavior more closely and whether or not you were committed to Mennonite principles. The church board wrote that it also hoped to discourage members from, quote, flooding into the Amsterdam congregation and becoming a burden. In 1709, they increased the waiting period to 3 years, further discouraging marginal Mennonites from coming to Amsterdam. And then they rejected at least 66 attestations of potential members. Some of them for people who were clearly only interested in the poor relief, some of them who do not know much about church doctrine, like Jan Graz and William Vos. And in a dramatic switch from Mennonite tradition, the board allowed Lisbeth Bongerts to take communion in 1703, but did not grant her membership, since it was not apparent that she had ever been a sister in the Mennonite congregation. Gerrit Smit had been a member in the Zonas congregation, but he was known to have been a troublesome member there. The board told him that they would not take him on as a member, but he should enjoy the freedom to take communion. So in other words, it's easier now to take communion and to become a member. By the 1710s, individuals with spots and wrinkles could take communion more easily than they could be added to the membership rolls. As the Golden Age lost its luster, marginal men and women may have needed help more than ever, yet it grew increasingly difficult for Amsterdam's downtowns to gain access to charity. By linking charity with church membership, discipline, and participation, the Lammists thereby protected their collective reputation, helped the city nourish its weakest members, and contributed to the social disciplining of the entire city. The magistrates recognized the importance of all the city's churches to care for the needy, and they passed a law granting all Protestant churches exemptions from new taxes in 1719. This is previously something that only the Reformed Church had enjoyed, and it was very important for the board to note that when they granted this exception. But the positive side of this is that when Dutch Mennonites appealed to officials on behalf of persecuted Mennonites in Switzerland or in Germany, they could always appeal to the reputation as well-heeled, obedient subjects. The discipline of violence shows that the boards adapted to the changing nature of their members. From the second half of the 17th century, there are essentially two tiers of Mennonites. Mennonites from the middling and elite classes like these, they're expected to behave and believe in a certain way, while members from the very lowest classes, or those living in the church housing, aren't held to quite the same expectations. So sort of, there's a little more leeway for violence and drinking and such and such. We aren't allowed to understand the faith commitments of these marginal members, but there's a few hints. In the records of the zone, which list both the date and the date of birth and the date of baptism, many of the offenders are about 14 years old, who have only, and they committed their infraction only a few years, sorry, many of the new members are baptized at 14, and they commit their infraction only a few years later. So they're relatively immature in their age and in their faith. Successful discipline requires vertical as well as horizontal pressure. Therefore, as the congregation's growing reluctance to have their leaders expose their moral failings, and the elders no longer preserve the purity of the communion table, this undercut the effectiveness of any congregational discipline. As the congregation no longer added marginal members, individuals to its membership list, it shaped itself into a gathering of solid, middle-class burghers, with a few peculiar beliefs about the oath and the sword. The emphasis of discipline shifts from safeguarding purity to defending propriety and the poor chest. They raised the bar for admission into the congregation. They found orphanages. They punished indolence, thereby raising collective reputation. So the sectarian and the ascetic practices of a church discipline intended to separate believers from the fallen world were no longer necessary to govern a group of upright burghers who had grown used to rubbing shoulders with the economic and political elites of the Republic. Thank you.
Her husband's honor, and I didn't see any, it's really an individual thing for the women.
There is, it does affect the whole congregation. That's what these elders are worried about. That the woman's dishonor, the woman, they use the word dishonorable behavior a lot. And they say it bothers them because it affects us, not just her. So yes.
Right. Yeah, you mentioned that apart from sailing to war, Mennonites and members of other confessions were disciplined for the same offenses. I was wondering if you have any sense of the frequency of discipline or the severity of discipline of Mennonites compared to those of other confessions.
I found that the patterns are roughly the same. So the Herman Rodenberg wrote a book in the mid-90s, and he traced it all, and he sort of the Mennonites maybe carry discipline about one generation longer. But the same patterns, the same increase during periods of economic downturn. So there's many more cases of extramarital sex during when there's an economic downturn, because there's extra men are off the war, there's more women than there are men. Rodenberg finds the same thing. Cases of, yeah, so that they really reflect each other quite a lot. Which is surprising to me. I thought they'd be harsher.
Troy, yeah. One of the great sadnesses of many historians is that people don't keep church minutes in that kind of interesting detail. What are future generations going to do if they want to write social history of what's going on in churches now?
Yeah. What are they going to do? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, email scares me as a historian. What's going to happen with that? I don't
know. Well, many organizations just record a final decision.
That's right. And now, it's fascinating to me. As a historian, there's some suggestion that there are black books that were kept that were destroyed. So we think that perhaps the discipline is actually higher than we found. Because, it's also interesting, I didn't mention, by the 18th century, somebody has gone through and scratched out the names of people in there. So they don't want to keep records of who was actually disciplined. So there's some of these concerns about record keeping later on, too. But when you have a congregation of 2,500 people, you need to know who can take communion and who can't, so you have to keep records of it.
Thanks, Jack.
It's a term, of course, developed in the 19th century, and it refers to the period between when the Dutch defeat the northern seven provinces of the Dutch Republic, cut themselves off from Spanish rule, and this is the period of economic growth. It's also related to their artistic growth, to the age of Rembrandt and Vermeer. It's the great period of building cities. They defeat the English four times in battle. They defeat Louis XIV, the great Sun King in battle. It's just this age of Dutch power and glory. And it stops at about 1700 as well. More that they're eclipsed by others than they lose their luster, but it just refers to that 17th century time when the Dutch were the most powerful, perhaps arguably the most powerful country in Europe. And there's these records of, you know, people, you've seen that Mennonite houses, farms in the middle of nowhere, have paintings in them. Right? You see levels of consumerism that we don't see anywhere else in Europe at the time. So
it's not just a reference, it's not a reference to the church.
No, it's a reference to just broader societal things like that.
Yeah, you mentioned a few instances where people were readmitted to communion if their conscience permitted them. Mm-hmm. So was that actually a phenomenon that sometimes their conscience didn't permit them, or was that more just a way of speaking?
It's not recorded that it stopped them. I don't know, that's not recorded, so it's some of the quiet voices in the archives. There's a case where the mayor of Amsterdam went up to the Dutch Mennonites and said, could I take communion with you? And they sort of, it's like a, Jesus answered, well, do you say you can take communion with me?
There's a question at the door. Given the Dutch example, do you think North American Mennonites are problematically or dangerously overly assimilationalist?
I would, I have glib answers. I don't think the danger was that they were assimilated. I think that the problem was that, I've been thinking about this as I wrote tonight, and I think the issue is that they are second-class citizens. So as they get wealthy, they become frustrated with the fact that they can't participate. They have a lot of wealth that they can't do what they want to do in society. So I think they leave the church for easier avenues towards social climbing. So if they had been equal to everybody else and they had that kind of wealth, I don't know what would have happened. So I don't think I don't know if there's danger of assimilation. I don't think so. I mean, the church in Holland still exists today. So it hasn't disappeared yet.
Do they practice any church discipline?
Well,
pardon?
Merlin asked if they practice church discipline.
Today.
Today.
Sermons, and I think elders' visits before the community, that strikes me as totally parallel to the Reformed and Presbyterian tradition. Do the Mennonites model themselves on that practice, or just that they come to it naturally?
So this question is, is the preparatory sermon and the elders' visit model on the Reformed practice? Probably, there's some influence there. I know that initially, the Reformed Church models himself after the Mennonites. John Calvin married a Mennonite, an ex-Anabaptist woman. The Reformed see themselves in competition with the Anabaptists and their reputation for upright behavior. But then there's a lot of influence brought in from the Reformed Church, singing psalms and things like that. I've been told recently that some churches in people's lifetimes, they would still have a preparatory sermon before communion in the Mennonite tradition. I'm not sure she's going to do that. So.
From your study of discipline in this century, have you learned anything that could be applied today that are positive forms of discipline? They all sound a little kind of distasteful.
Was it all distasteful? The thing I hope I was trying to stress today is that these people who were disciplined were generally on the margins of society already. There's very few cases of it. Somebody who is just going about their business and does something wrong. I mean, these people they have serious problems with alcohol often, and they're in debt, and they're on their way on the margins anyway. So it doesn't feel like, I get the impression Ontario Mennonites are quite wealthy. I don't see the same kind of social dynamics going on today. I think there are interesting questions, and Ed Jansen and I have had these questions about what it means to take communion together. So we're going to have a debate about this, about open communion or not, but I think there's questions about the union around the communion table today. I'm not sure it's about discipline or not. I'm going to avoid that question. Jeremy Berg is the theologian of the 21st century.
Okay,
Ed.
You're
going to
have to debate another time.
Not on communion. I'm trying to understand, sort of, just before you wound up, you made a comment around wanting to be like the rest of society, and there's that assimilationist piece in there. Is the discipline aimed at trying to create honor for the Mennonites among the rest of society?
Yeah, but that's because they are already part of it. And that's what I'm arguing. It's not a case that they want to. They don't think in sort of particularly Mennonite ways. Like we think of the Amish, humility, and they have Orton and things like that. They are doing these things because they are like the people around them.
So the follow-up is, being a second-class citizen creates an anxiety, and out of that anxiety comes this pressure to discipline?
No, discipline, everybody has that pressure. The anxiety comes when they feel frustrated because they are wealthy, and they're educated, and they can't run for office. So when Napoleon comes, Mennonites are the first to sign up to serve in his government because he gives everybody equality. So his top two or three Dutch supporters are Mennonites, who are ready to sign up.
How does this era relate to numeric rise and decline in the Dutch Mennonite Church?
The 1700s are a significant era of decline. I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, I'm sorry. But and I think when you have 30 year members are marrying outside of the congregation and joining those congregations. There's at least six congregations in 1700. By 1800, they're down to one. Because they close and then they join up together. That's why the name of the congregation today in Amsterdam is still the United Amsterdam Mennonite Congregation. But Andy Hendels is the coming to Amsterdam. So this is a talk about that, it's all those congregations. So they just couldn't support it.
One more question,
Dr.
Tom.
Thank you, Troy. To see whether I understood the one connection I thought you were making, maybe you can stress that again. Given the fact that most of the people you said who were disciplined were already, you might say, marginal to society with a lot of social problems, and given the fact that the communities were trying to protect their honor, what is the relationship between church discipline and trying to deal with poverty and social dysfunction and trying to protect, you might say, the congregational purse from being squandered on with little chance of return?
Right. That's a huge thing. I glided over a little at the end and concerns about time. But they take their obligation to take care of their poor seriously. And at the same time, there's a growing expectation that the poor need to rise to a certain level of behavior. So they ask all the poor to come to church one Sunday, and they admonish everybody that we're tired of being taking communion and never coming to a church service. So now they take attendance on a Sunday, everybody comes, and they tick off people who are coming, saying, if you're going to get in the charity books, you need to come and take care of them. Then the largest records of the congregation, which I haven't done much with, but which Mary Sprunger has, are the deacon's records. They keep track of who got turf this week to burn, who got bedding for their house. And they're very much, that is what the church board deals a lot with. And so they're worried about the purse. They're worried about it. But they still have a lot of money and they can deal with it. At the same time, they're collecting money to ship Swiss Anabaptists to North America. They have a sense of charity. They have a very strong sense of charity. They create a fund to prevent drunkenness. They create the first firefighters fund. I mean, that's very much a social engagement idea that they have. But I think it's, yeah.
I wonder if you talk about the fact that they needed access to capital. Where did they get their capital? Did they originate their family? Were there businesses? Or?
The dynamics are a bit gray because the records, the earliest days aren't there, but when the war ends with Spain, a bunch of the Flemish Mennonites move up north, and they bring with them skills and capital that they take out of what's now Belgium to the north, and those people are the first people to invest in it. And then the wealthiest families marry together, so they do keep the money within the church, and then that's where they invest in all kinds of different companies. The Dutch Mennonites have monopoly on whaling in the North Sea. They build on it and they build on it together.
How did they determine
I've seen one list where they draw up a list of all the wealthy members and say, we're going to go talk to all these people to give us money. There are lots of wheels in there because I haven't done anything with it yet.
Thank you. There's an opportunity to ask Troy more questions. We have a reception waiting for us down in the atrium, but I would just say no quarreling over the punch. Don't worry about that. I think I'll escort Troy downstairs, so he isn't the last one left up here in the chapel. While you won't want to talk to him, please do stay and visit. Thanks for coming out tonight, and join me in thanking Troy for some